Hello and welcome to a special edition of the State of the Fleet Industry video series that's produced by Automotive Fleet Magazine. And the purpose of this video series is to put a spotlight on leaders in today's fleet management industry. And today I have the honor of interviewing Patti Earley, CAFM, who is the Fleet Fuel Operations Specialist for Florida Power and Light, and who is also the current president of the NAFA Fleet Management Association. So thank you, Patti, for joining us.
Well, thank you, Mike, for inviting me.
Great. So let's start our conversation by focusing on the area that encompasses your job responsibilities. So I'd like to start the discussion and tap into your expertise there as to what you see as the latest trends in fleet fuel management, and what do you see as the latest operational trends in fleet fuel management?
So with fuel management, as with everything else in fleet, you know, technology is constantly changing and constantly evolving. Fleet fuel cards are adding a lot of functionality. You have the ability to look at fueling trends in your fleet, where your drivers are fueling, average costs. Really gives you the ability to look at outliers in, you know, the numbers of transactions and fueling frequencies and other type of exceptions that you note. They're giving you analytic and benchmarking functionality platforms, which are great, gives you lots and lots of information. Also, they're making a lot of strides in fraud protection, which is a big issue right now. I probably get 3 or 4 fraud notifications a week. So they're looking at ways, you know, to counteract that. One thing I've been hearing about that I find kind of exciting that, you know, coming in the not too distant future, will have the potential to not have to use that plastic fuel card. You'll be able to authorize your transactions using your phone, which I think is a great thing. And I think that'll actually help with the fraud protection too. For operations that have on-site fueling facilities, you know, there's so much more capability in an automated data capture. You can get odometer readings, do engine diagnostics, you know, while you're fueling the vehicle. Also, you know, in the world of telematics, there are a lot of telematics advantages that can help you with things like idle reduction, again, fuel exceptions, you know, people doing things that are out of the norm of what they're normally doing. Also, things like route management to help you reduce your fuel use. I know there are a number of fleets who are also looking at things like eco-driver training. So, you know, making your drivers more efficient so you're getting better fuel economy. And with that, sometimes there are folks I have talked to that will actually have competitions between their drivers and, you know, reward good behavior. So, you know, everyone I think has kind of a competitive nature. So, you know, just a few things that are going on.
Yeah, very exciting time, especially on the technology end. And I've heard the same things there. It's pretty exciting, and really, it does seem to offer a good remedy to this fuel fraud program, which is a lot more widespread than a lot of people consider. This is an industry-wide issue that might have
Definitely.
A good opportunity to thwart. So, you know, let's go off on another end right now. You know, one of the unique things about your position, Patti, as president of NAFA, that puts you in contact with a lot of different fleet manager members, people that are in the commercial fleet side of the business, public sector, utilities, university fleets, and so on. And it gives you an opportunity to have a very unique perspective on the broader industry as a whole. So taking advantage of that, let me ask this question. What is your assessment or the assessment of the NAFA group as to how the fleet industry is going to be emerging in a post-pandemic business environment?
That's a very interesting question. I have talked to a number of other fleet managers. You know, for some organizations, it's going to involve, you know, reduced budgets. For other organizations, it's not. You know, some industries have slowed down over the pandemic. Other industries have been busier. So depending on the segment that you're in your particular organization, I think is going to have some influence on your post-pandemic operations. Government operations, I think, are going to be experiencing budget cuts. I know there are some of my corporate friends, too, who are talking about you know, slowdown in business. So they're looking at budget cuts. So they're really going to need to look at the way that they're doing business. You know, in fleet, it seems like we are always really striving to improve our efficiencies. But I think coming out of this, that's going to be even more prevalent. They might be looking at things like, you know, postponing vehicle purchases or hiring freezes. I think one thing that definitely is going to happen is there'll be a lot more attention paid to the right sizing of your fleet as business changes to whatever that new normal is going to be. You know, with more people working from home and less in-person meetings, there might be people with take-home vehicles that no longer need take-home vehicles. So fleets may be looking at things like utilizing more rentals or, you know, ride sharing. Although I have heard from some folks who are now a little more reluctant to look at ride sharing. Mm-hmm. You know, they're looking at using their own vehicles and just being a lot more careful about sanitizing and cleaning and that type of thing.
Yeah. Now, speaking specific to Florida Power and Light, your utility, you haul around a lot of work crews. What's Florida Power and Light's policy in regards to that issue? And how do you handle social distancing in that context?
So we actually, our fleet has expanded due to this because a lot of those crews that used to ride together all the time are not riding together now. So they are, you know, we've had to rent vehicles and use other vehicles so that those crews are not in the same vehicle, you know, to mm-hmm. keep them socially distanced.
Is that temporary with the rentals, or are you actually looking to increase the size of your fleet?
I think that's something going forward, you know, probably in our next year is something that we'll be looking at.
Okay. Interesting times. So getting back to your NAFA responsibilities, I'd like to explore with you what are NAFA's current initiatives under your leadership and how you feel those initiatives are going to be influencing the association in the coming years.
Okay. So we just finished our strategic planning initiative with our board of directors. So every 3 years, the board sits down, we reach out to other people in the association and really look at where we want to be going in the next 3 years. So we have a lot of efforts going on around our communities and our chapters and really ways to add value to our membership. So over the next few months, you'll see enhanced efforts, not only with our NAFA communities and chapters, we're really trying to make them more dynamic. But also working with allied organizations to ensure that we're really serving the interests of our entire membership and the entire fleet industry. We've already started talks to establish an industry calendar that will highlight events from other fleet organizations. And as you know, Mike, we're working on some collaborative efforts with other organizations to really speak with one voice from the fleet industry and to also share access to things like training and resources.
Go ahead. Well, I think those are very commendable initiatives. And I think, you know, it's really the future direction, I think, of the industry. I think if I had to summarize the future direction of the industry, it's more collaboration, working, as you said, with a single voice. We all have underlying common interests. There may be specifics that divide us or separate us, but the underlying fundamentals are the same.
Right. So we're also looking at some ways, you know, to evolve the I&E. 2020 has really forced us to take a hard look at the event and transitioning to virtual. So we're having to do some things differently. So one of those things we're doing is really looking at what our members want and where they find value. In the near future, we plan on launching an I&E advisory council that's made up of exhibitors, attendees, and also, you know, constituent organizations to help shape what that event is going to look like coming up. Mm-hmm. And then in addition, you know, NAFA's mainstay, of course, is our education and certification. So we've launched a number of new online training initiatives. We're trying to focus on members that are experiencing our training and the content maybe for the first time. You know, we've always had members who don't have the ability to travel to attend our in-person events. So now I really think this expansion of our online training is going to help them. And again, we're going to be reaching out to our members and our constituents to get, you know, feedback related to the training and certification.
Very good.
And then, of course, we're going to continue to work, toward our legislative efforts. Pat O'Connor and Hugh Williams, you know, from Canada, are our folks that are on the forefront there. And we want to continue to make sure that, you know, whatever's going on legislatively is in the best interest of our fleets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are some terrific initiatives. I'm going to make a prediction, though. I'm going to predict that the one thing that you're going to be most remembered for as a past NAFA president is you're going to have the distinction of creating the very first virtual I&E conference. And I was wondering if, and that's coming up soon, so I was wondering if you might be able to give the viewers a sneak preview of what to expect and why they should consider attending.
Well, and thank you for that. And I really don't like being the first president to be able to do this because I would much prefer to see everyone in person. I think that really adds its value. But the great thing with this platform that we're using is we're really trying to make it feel as real and as in person of event as we possibly can. So we're doing things like, you know, every attendee is going to be sent a swag bag. So you'll get a little goodie bag. There'll be full-fledged chat and networking features that we hope can really make the virtual event, look like something that you're more or less attending in person. It'll give you a true, really networking and interactive experience. We're using an automated connection builder app. This is a peer matching app that'll help build connections with other fleet professionals around the world. So the attendee will fill out a profile, and the application is going to provide you your top 20 connections based on your profile. It'll match you with other attendees that have the same interests that you do, and it's also going to match fleet professionals with suppliers based on product interests that you have. And from the supplier front, it's going to match suppliers with attendees, not other suppliers. So it'll help the supplier kind of build a new network and relationships with people interested in their products.
Those are some pretty,
go ahead. It's some pretty sophisticated software, so I'm really excited about it. Mm-hmm. We'll also have 7 targeted chat lounges, so whatever fleet segment that you're in, you'll have a chat lounge, you know, directly for you. Following each session, there'll be moderators that'll lead interactive discussions. There's 4 great general sessions coming up. Kevin Brown is our keynote. I'm really excited about his presentation, the hero effect, being your best when it matters the most. We'll have the always popular Flexley Award winner panel, a panel of fleet managers talking about pandemic response. And then one other thing that I'm very excited about is a session on the state of the industry. And it's a collaborative effort between NAFA, AFLA, and NTA. And thank you very much. Mike will be moderating that for us.
Yeah, thank you. My pleasure and honor to do so. So anyway, I think we've reached the limit of our interview. I want to thank you for a great conversation and detailed, in-depth conversation. I've learned a lot of new things out of this. So just one last thing. If someone wanted to get more information on the NAFA Virtual I&E, how would they do so?
They just need to go online at NAFA.org, and all the information they need is right there.
Perfect. That's easy. Well, thank you very much, Patti, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Mike.